This is the first time I've ever gotten to introduce one of my grade school friends as a grand round speaker. Michael Fine and I grew up in the same little town in New Jersey, and he had to remind me this morning that he was younger than I was. I said, yeah, we were grade school colleagues. He said, yeah, but I was younger. So he's just, I won't say retired, but he just left the position of being the health commissioner in Rhode Island and the largest state in the United States. And the thing that I loved about, and Michael and I get together almost every summer because I love vacationing up there. And the thing that I loved about talking to Michael is he would say, you know, Rhode Island, you can do Rhode Island. Like, you could actually conceive of developing a brand new healthcare system on a completely different vision and a completely different model and actually sort of make it happen here. And so I would listen to sort of the war stories about how you actually could, like, sort of wrap your arms around it and actually imagine like a brand new health system with rural and urban and everything all sort of organized. And this is really loud. And the amazing thing about it was Michael, as a family doc, basically the entire vision is built around a primary care delivery system, like around family medicine, and how you basically build a system around that. And I always found that to be amazing. And he's written a book that basically describes this vision. And I recently was with somebody who worked for the governor there, and I said, so, oh, you must know my friend Michael Fine. And he had a big smile on his face, and he said, yep. He said, he actually came and believed that we could change the entire healthcare system in Rhode Island, and he almost did it. There's a long introduction written here, and I'm not actually going to read it because he's done so many things. But the amazing reason that I brought him here is because he really does have a different way of looking at the world, kind of the way we as people in family medicine look at the world. And I asked him if he would just come and sort of share that vision and sort of and his insights about how the real economics of how healthcare works. So, Michael, thank you.
Good morning. It's really a great treat to be here. I live in Rhode Island, but I am really a New Yorker. And it's a great treat for a couple of reasons. The biggest is that, you know, when somebody admits to being a few years older than you, he may not realize, but that somebody was somebody I looked up to. And to be here, understanding what he's done and what he's built is by itself pretty astounding. And it's also, you know, being in this place has a fair amount of emotional meaning for me. Both of my grandmothers died in this hospital. My family came from the Bronx. I was born about 4 miles north of here. And I cut my teeth in healthcare in the South Bronx. And actually, it was the first time Neil and I's paths crossed in healthcare. I got to work as a community health organizer on 167th Street and 3rd Avenue, in a place where, in those years, there was really nothing left. There were no doctors, there were no pharmacies, there was no nothing, other than one healthcare center, one community healthcare center, Martin Luther King Health Center. And I got to go building by building, trying to organize in buildings around healthcare and connecting people up to it. We trained a couple of organizers in each building, a couple of community health workers, and then tried to connect them to residents in the residency program in family medicine at Montefiore, where Dr. Kalman was a resident. So I spent many days trying to get him to come to the phone when he was busy doing 10 other things. And he and a bunch of other residents, and we built the beginnings of what could have been a little healthcare system, and actually lasted for 5 or 6 years after that. But it was a real experience in looking at healthcare from the ground up, from not what we do in our buildings, but what communities experience when they think about health and healthcare. And that was kind of simultaneous with working as a ghostwriter for a corrupt cardiologist. It's a true story, who practiced on 85th Street and Park. So I really have been in this neighborhood. And that's a story by itself, but that was a guy who loved to publish but didn't like to research or write. So I actually got to write the classic article in the literature at the time on tennis elbow. So I know more about lateral epicondylitis than you would like ever could imagine. But there were some other experiences that really made me look at medicine not as a healing art or as a community building process, but more as a way to make money, which is what he was about. And I went to medical school and residency, and then I went to the National Health Service Corps and got to practice in the mountains of East Tennessee, in the fifth poorest county in the United States. Now, I was an urban guy, and it was a little surprising to be in the mountains of East Tennessee, to say the least. But I got another look at things. I got to practice in a county which had two physicians who were internship but not residency trained, where the two physicians rented the county hospital from the county for $1 a year. And by the way, they were county judges, so they kind of controlled the county's political apparatus. Every single person who got who came to the emergency department, which was staffed by an LPN, everybody who came in got a shot of lincomycin, Benadryl, and Kenalog, assuming that that would cure almost anything that people came in with, and they were right sometimes, actually. Where they didn't have a lab and didn't have an operating room and still did maternity care, and their approach to failure to progress in labor was to call the helicopter and pray. They did a lot of praying. We had one of the highest infant mortality rates in the country. And what was amazing about that place, which was 66 or 67% illiterate, was that most people lived in the direst poverty you would ever imagine, but the two doctors each had 7,000 acres of land and ran herds of purebred cattle. And that was really a place where medicine was, it was my first view of medicine as a wealth extraction system, not a healthcare system. And then I started a practice, and which would become the largest family medicine, the largest family practice in the smallest state in America, which means it wasn't really that big. And in the, along the way, worked as a vice president of contracting for an IPA. And I, in order to figure out how to do the contracting, I finally realized I needed to know what it cost us to provide care. So one day in 1996, I sat at a kitchen table in the little practice that we had put together and did a very simple piece of math. I took what it cost us to run the practice for a year, including what we paid ourselves, and divided it by the number of people we served. And I found a number that made me want to do the math again. It was my first experience in figuring out that I had the zeros wrong, and I had to recheck my math. Because when I ran the numbers, what I got was it was costing us $106 per person per year to provide primary care. And we were a pretty radical kind of practice. You know, we took care of all our patients. We were really on call 24 hours a day. We rounded at three hospitals. $106 per person per year. Ended up, as a result of that, writing a paper with a colleague who was the chair of the Department of Economics at Bryan College, because I couldn't believe it. But we validated the number and discovered not only was, does it cost $106 per person, or did it then cost $106 per person per year for us to provide all the primary care, you know, a couple thousand people needed. But that cost was about the cost of other essential services that communities provide for themselves. So, you know, building roads, when you really look at it over the population, you know, a couple $100 per person per year. Police and fire protection, a couple $100 per person per year. Education, when you run the number not over the number of school kids, but over the population of the entire community, it's probably two or three times that, but like $800 per person per year, and we were 106. And that began an interesting thought process that said, well, if it's so cheap and so important, why don't we give it away? And then I said, well, let me work on this from a policy perspective. It'll take 10 years to get people to sort of see this. And that was 21 years ago, and I'm still at it. So what can I tell you? It's a little harder than that. But at the same time, in the community in which I lived, which is called Scituate, Rhode Island, through some happenstances, talking to the city council at the time of the demise of a large HMO in Rhode Island, and people getting suddenly worried about healthcare costs, we developed a little group in town that's now called the Scituate Health Alliance that started figuring out how to do things and how to build toward a single primary care center that would take care of the entire population of the city, the town. It's a rural town. It can't be called a city. But it's a population of 10,000 people. And we did all sorts of things over the years. One time, or pretty much every year for the last 15 years, we do flu vaccine campaigns and, you know, do some of those clinics at the time of elections. So you come in, you vote, you get a flu shot. We did prenatal education, prematernity education for folks who are pregnant in town. We actually studied our population and discovered that in a town of 10,000 where we had about 100 deliveries a year, those deliveries were performed by 60 different obstetricians. So that the disorganization of what appears to be a healthcare system, we began to see that as quite profound. And actually, over the years, we kept working toward this, you know, we're going to build a thing, you know, one place that takes care of everybody. And I'm pleased to report that in October, the second neighborhood health station in the United States opened in Scituate, Rhode Island. So we have doctors and nurses, and we have a primary care practice that aims to take care of the entire population of the city of Scituate. And then, as Neil told you, I sort of woke up one morning and found myself the director of the Department of Health in Rhode Island. And we articulated this notion called the Rhode Island Primary Care Trust, which doesn't yet exist, but, you know, it's not the case that we haven't gotten there, it's just we haven't gotten there yet. But that argued that we ought to be able to build in Rhode Island a healthcare system, with one neighborhood health station, and I'll talk about that in a little bit, for every 10,000 people. It's open from 8 o'clock in the morning till 8 at night, and is broadly multidisciplinary, and it serves 90% of, or provides 90% of the healthcare services people need, and do it in a way that 90% of the community wants to use those services. And that gives you all sorts of potential public health advantages when you bring everybody into a single medical record, something Dr. Kalman really pioneered. Along the way, he taught me all sorts of things about how you can use the electronic medical record in the service of primary care. You found Legionella disease in Parkchester, if my memory's right. Well, it was a pretty good story, by looking at daily temperatures. I never forgot that, and it really tells you the power, not just of the EMR, but of bringing an entire population into one clinical enterprise. And as a result of that, because of a unique combination in the city of Central Falls, Rhode Island, where I'm now working, of a mayor who was young and progressive, and of a community organization that was interested in making sure we brought healthcare to everyone, we actually were able to open the first neighborhood health station in the United States that really will quickly serve 90% of the population. We're up to about 60% of the population already, and do it in a way that 90% of the folks want to use it and provide 90% of the services. So we now have, as part of the neighborhood health station, we have urgent care and primary care and mental behavior health care and substance use treatment and physical therapy and lab and x-ray all in one place. And you know, before too much time, it will be open from 7 in the morning till 8 at night and open on weekends, which is really the way, in my view, we're going to stop unnecessary emergency department utilizations and unnecessary hospitalization and provide some way to control healthcare cost. That's kind of by way of background about how I got to both see healthcare as we now do it as a wealth extraction system, kind of a big Ponzi scheme, and to understand primary care as the disruptive innovation for social justice in health, which is what I'll talk about as we go along. So before I get started, I want to talk about a couple of heroes in addition to Dr. Kalman. The first is Bernie Lau, who's 95 years old and lives in Chestnut Hill, outside of Boston. He is a giant who walks the earth. He invented the defibrillator, designed modern CCU care. Lau-Levin-Ganong syndrome, a pre-excitation syndrome, is named after him. He started Physician for Social Responsibility with Vic Seidel and Jack Geiger. He started an organization called IPPNW, the International Physicians to Prevent Nuclear War, with a colleague from Russia, and get this, 400,000 other physicians. And they together, by being such incredible advocates, triggered nuclear disarmament in the early 80s and brought the end of the Cold War. Doctors did that. And for that, he won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1985. And the great story about him winning the Nobel Peace Prize is his mother was still alive, and they went to Stockholm to pick up the prize, and she came with him. He went up to accept the prize, and he accepted it, and in Dr. Lau's usual tradition, I'm sure gave a stirring and quite strident speech, came down to accept congratulations. And his mother turned to him and said, "Peace Prize, you couldn't win the prize in medicine?" The other person I want to talk about is Jack Geiger, who with luck I'm going to go see this afternoon. Dr. Geiger was a founder of Physician Responsibility, Physicians for Human Rights, a founder of the Medical Committee for Human Rights. He's been deeply tied to the civil rights movement since boyhood. And he founded the Community Health Center movement in the United States by himself in the early 60s. The story is long and involved, but the Community Health Center movement in the United States started in two places, in Columbia Point outside of Boston and in Mound Bayou, Mississippi. It is now 375 health centers, which I'm sure you guys know lots about because of Dr. Kalman. 9,000 sites, takes care of 25 million Americans, almost 10% of our population, and probably is the model for the healthcare system we all need once we get to healthcare, once we begin to understand the value of a healthcare system itself. And he said famously in Mountain Bayou, where the predominant public health problem was malnutrition, he said, the last time I checked my textbooks, the specific therapy for malnutrition was, in fact, food. Jack talks like that. And he started prescribing food. And that began to people to start thinking about social determinants of health in a new way. He's 91 and lives right off Cadman Plaza in Brooklyn. So let me talk about healthcare economics with those guys in the back of your mind. The United States spent $3.2 trillion on healthcare last year. That's a bigger chunk of the U.S. economy than manufacturing. It's bigger than agriculture. The federal government spends more on healthcare than it does on the military, and that's just the government. The rest of us spend almost as much as the government altogether, though the government spends about 64% of every dollar we spend on healthcare. In Rhode Island, tiny little place, million people, yes, it really is a state, we spent $12 billion on healthcare as a state. The entire state budget is $7 billion. $3 billion of that went to healthcare. New York, I looked this up, spent $240 billion on healthcare. The entire state budget is only $324 billion. $63 billion of the state spend went to healthcare. Healthcare inflation has been running 6 to 12% for the last 30 years. That's 2 to 3 times the rate of overall inflation. In Rhode Island, that means healthcare inflation represents $600 million in a single year. That's a number that's equivalent to the salaries of 13,000 people, almost more people than exist in the whole state. That's a joke. In New York, healthcare inflation represents $14 billion a year, and that's the cost of 200,000 teacher salaries. So money that ought to be going to education, which is more important as a predictor of health status than medical care, more money is being wasted on healthcare that's unnecessary than we spend on teachers who we need. Now, you know, the top line is a heading from an article in the New York Times. Your mayor and your governor were sparring over the cost of affordable housing. What a surprise, they seem to spar over the cost of over almost everything. See, I'm still a New Yorker. $14 billion, the cost, not the cost of healthcare, the cost of the additional cost in 1 year in New York State is the cost of building 28,000 units of affordable housing. Even in New York, an affordable housing unit costs $500,000. It's twice the cost of Rhode Island, but it's still 28,000 units of affordable housing we could build if we had that $14 billion. That 28,000 units can house 112,000 people. The homeless population in New York City is 60,000. When I ran these numbers, it really almost made me cry, because the money that's being wasted on healthcare inflation is exactly what it would cost to house the homeless in the state of New York. And $245 billion, the total cost of healthcare in New York, is equivalent to the gross national product of either Pakistan, Ireland, Greece, Portugal, or the Czech Republic, whole countries. And the $14 billion, the cost inflation, is equivalent to the GDP of Zimbabwe, Mozambique, Botswana, or the nation of Georgia. Just to give you some context. Oops, that got put in the wrong place. Healthcare inflation has gobbled up all new public investment in education, public housing, public transportation, and community development. Those budgets have been flat or declining for the last 30 years, while healthcare costs are through the roof. And that's the world in which we work, and we are part of this. Just to give you a feel for what that inflation means, the percent of average family income consumed by health insurance in 2003 was 17%. Right now it's 30%. In 2025, it's predicted to be 50%. And in 2032, the Congressional Budget Office predicts it will be 100%. Now you tell me how that works economically. Maybe you can figure it out. I can't, it just doesn't make any sense to me. And yet clearly it's what's happening. Because we've been working for the last 30 years on trying to contain this stuff. And look, since in the last 15 years, it went up from 17% to 30%. It turns out that all the money that should be that should come out as wages, all the money that should come out as salary increases, is coming out as support coming out of people's pockets, supporting the extra cost of health insurance. And in addition, if that wasn't bad enough, we waste between 30 and 50 cents of every healthcare dollar. And you all see this every day. We waste it on unnecessary treatments and tests, on preventable disease, on fraud, on ridiculous prices for everything. And you've seen what pharma has done to the cost of the simplest medications. You know, doxycycline used to be cheaper than water. And now it's like 70 bucks a pill. You know, and on bloated overhead and for-profit insurance, you know, what we pay in salaries for healthcare executives, for the CEOs of hospitals and the CEOs of insurance companies, many of which are nonprofit, makes me embarrassed every single day. And what's even worse is that 64% of the money we spend is public money. This isn't, you know, coming out of private pockets. This is all a public spend. And we do that through Medicare and Medicaid and the VA and TRICARE and CHIP, but it's all public money. And if you look at hospitals, and I had the opportunity to be the regulator of the hospital system in Rhode Island for a couple of years, that those hospitals, all of which have private boards and all of which believe that they're competing with each other, and all of which, only in Rhode Island, of course, put up big signs on the highway advertising their wonderful services. They're all public institutions, except they're not. They're publicly funded institutions that are running like sort of private for-profit institutions. And what's painful about that spend is that medical care is actually responsible for only about 10% of public health outcomes. Most public health outcomes are due to social factors, to education and income, to race as a marker for the impact of racism on the personal health of individuals, not to genetics on the race side. There's a genetic component to healthcare outcomes, but, and this is another discussion, but race has basically no biologic meaning from a healthcare perspective, to environmental exposures and to genetics after all. And healthcare wastes more money than we spend on paying all public school teachers in the United States, on building and maintaining all our roads and bridges, on police and fire departments in all 50 states, and on the Navy and Air Force combined.
How are you defining waste?
Waste is that 30% that most healthcare economics recognize doesn't contribute to healthcare, to even medical care outcomes. That's unnecessary testing and overutilization. This comes from a wonderful book by my colleague Shannon Brownlee called Overtreated. But I think there's pretty good consensus in the health policy community that we spend 30% that we didn't need to spend. And I'll talk in a minute about international comparisons that make me think it's probably more like 50%.
Does that also include the healthcare that's delivered that could have been preventable?
Yes. Oh, okay. That's part of the equation. And that, you know, that's something we think about a lot. That preventable diseases that didn't get prevented. and the cost of those. So as I said, you know, this is a great wealth extraction system. It has nothing to do with health. It has to do with the production of profit. And to make it worse, even though we're paying for all this wonderful stuff, or we're paying all this money, our public health stinks. We have failed as a public health enterprise, despite what we're paying. So our infant mortality rate is 3 times nations with the best health outcomes. Life expectancy in the United States is 3 to 5 years shorter. And for white men, 45 to 54, our life expectancy is actually declining. And we have shocking health disparities. African-American mortality is still 3 times white infant mortality in 2017, 3 times. And that's in the United States, where our total mortality is 3 times the infant mortality of the best nations. And life expectancy with African-American men with a high school education or less is 14 years shorter than life expectancy for white men with college educations. Life expectancy for people with disabilities is 25 years shorter than people without disabilities. But we're all doing okay. We get to go to work every day, and you know, we're surviving, and people need medical care. And so, you know, we kind of do what we have to do to get through the day. But you know, when you put it together, you have to ask yourself sometimes, have we met the enemy and just discovered that the enemy is us? Are we complicit? You know, are we, you know, either willing or unwilling co-conspirators? Or perhaps, and I think I like this idea a lot better, knowing the people I know, are we experts with attitudes, the ghosts in the machine, the people who know but don't yet quite know they know, the people who are ready to lead but haven't led yet, the people with the moral conscience of a generation, the people who can and must lead the change? And obviously I'm here to argue the latter. And so I want to draw a distinction between the role of primary care and economically, and what else is going on in the system. The per person per year cost of healthcare in the United States is $10,000, about. Just health insurance company administrative cost is 10 to 20% in exchange products. It's actually unlimited in private insurance, so probably 20 to 30%. That means we spend $2,000 per person per year or more just on health insurance company overhead, salaries, and profit. The per person per year of primary care, the per person per year cost of primary care is 5% or less of the per person per year healthcare spend. So we spend $500 per person per year on primary care, even though you guys get to take calls at 2 in the morning, and you guys get to fill out forms, and you guys maintain personal relationships with people over time, and listen to families, and listen to people, and you're doing it for $500 per person per year, when the blinking insurance companies are getting $2,000 per person per year. And even though 50% of patient contact every day is with a primary care clinician or practice, not with an insurance company, and not with an academic health center, just saying. And then it turns out, even more painfully, that the best performing healthcare systems in the world spend a whole lot less, something like $2,200 to $4,500 per person per year. And of those, they spend 50% on primary care. And when you run the numbers, that means they're spending 2 to 4 times in real dollars what we spend. I had 2 experiences that kind of helped me understand this. One, when I was in state government, I got to lead a economic development mission to Israel for the state of Rhode Island. And, you know, I sort of got to sneak away and go visit the Ministry of Health. And we kind of did a little, you show me yours, I'll show me mine. I had a friend who was the deputy minister. And, you know, just to compare a little bit so we could understand a little more about our healthcare system. Now, Israel is more comparable to the United States than you might think. They are technologically developed. About 20% of each country is socially disadvantaged and has been socially disadvantaged sort of for many years. And that has its own impact on health outcomes and on health costs. But we both have, embarrassingly, 20% of a population that's functionally disenfranchised. So what is Israel's infant mortality rate? It's half of what ours is. What is Israel's life expectancy? It's 3 years longer for men, 5 years longer for women. What is Israel's per person per year cost? It's $2,200. We're $10,000. So I asked, you know, we're trying to figure out why this is happening. So I asked a question that my friend Chris Kohler, who runs the Milbank Fund, told me to ask. And I said, okay, what percent of your total spend is on primary care? And the vice minister said, well, like everybody else is in the world, we spend 50% on primary care. 50% of everything they spend goes to primary care. We spend 5%. And there's the difference right there. Israel is a country like many other countries where their health outcomes are focused or determined by the fact that everybody has a primary care practice, and that primary care practice is responsible and thinking about the health care of everybody in the country. And then I'm finishing another book about what a healthcare system is and what it's for. And I said, you know, from an international comparison perspective, it might be interesting to look at the countries with the best health outcomes and lowest costs and see how they organize themselves. So I spent a little time online and figured out that there are probably four countries that are like that, and one turns out to be Finland. Now, why is Finland particularly interesting? A little light went off in my brain. When Dr. Kalman and I were, you know, in our training and a couple years after, that was when people started working out the relationship between the treatment of hypercholesterolemia and heart disease and stroke. And all those papers, all those early papers on the treatment of heart disease, all those papers had authors with really funny sounding names, Finnish names, because in Finland at that time had the highest heart disease mortality in the world. Their mortality rates were abysmal because of diet and exercise. And what did they do? They did two things. First of all, they kind of developed a kind of guerrilla system of folks who worked on lifestyle. They used to go into the pubs and got people off bar stools to go do cross-country skiing. They incentivized people and urged people, and they changed their food system so the sausage they made, which used to be filled with pork fat, now has mushrooms in it, which they grow themselves, and they help their economy by growing better food. And the other thing they did was they went around the country, and for every 10,000 people, they opened one primary care center that's open from 8 o'clock in the morning till 8 at night and open on weekends, and has all the services that people need so people could and would get primary care close to home. This is not rocket science. They turned the health of their population around, and they did it by making sure everybody had meaningful, accessible primary care right in their own communities. And that's what they do that we don't do, but that's what makes you guys and the work we have to do together so different. We have not met the enemy, and the enemy is us. We are the solution to the problem. But we have to develop some of the courage we need to stand up and make it happen. Effectively, we have to revolt. And I talked about that already, that the best healthcare systems are built around primary care. You know, a lot of people are worried right now about what happens if we lose the Affordable Care Act. If we lose the Affordable Care Act, there are reasons for thinking, in my view, that healthcare expense will accelerate and healthcare will become more affordable and will wreck the economy, and that's the bad news. But the worst news is The same thing will happen if we keep the Affordable Care Act, only it will happen faster, because what we've done with the Affordable Care Act, as better as it is than what we had, is we've sort of done insurance reform without building a healthcare system. What we have got to do if we're going to basically save the economy and help protect democracy is what we've got to do is build a healthcare system. So what should everybody do? I mean, the bad news is that nobody else knows this but you, and you guys really have the sense, you have the skills and the ability to do this. The good news is you can do this. This is a learnable skill. The move to community organizing is a doable thing. So, don't mourn, organize. Don't worry, change it. First, learn and share this data. You know, there's a link to the economics data that's up online. Second, it's really worthwhile knowing the incidence and prevalence of disease in your own community, and to use that data every chance you get. And it's worthwhile picturing that data not only as percentages, but as people. So in Central Falls, where I work, 2 years ago, 49 girls got pregnant in high school. This year, it's 27 girls. And we're going to try to make it zero. And we're going to try to make it zero with Nexplanon, basically. But that number and that difference has real meaning when you talk to people and policymakers. But the only way it has meaning is if you know the numbers and you quote it every chance you can get. Third, it's worth, you know, I'll go to the opening of an envelope. That's quoting Buddy Cianci, the late interesting mayor of Providence who got himself in trouble all the time. He would go to the opening of an envelope. But, you know, take every opportunity you can and be with community organizations and help them understand what's going on and what's happening on their backs. And then the other thing you can do is to try to duplicate what we did in Scituate, which is basically invite 5 people you know and agree to meet once a month and invent things that you can do to build a healthcare system in your own community. If you live in a neighborhood or small town, start slow, you know, but start building a local healthcare system so that we build this one little healthcare system at a time. In Rhode Island now, we have 2 neighborhood health stations, and there are 3 more communities that are meeting regularly on their way to doing this. And remember as you go that the perfect is the enemy of the good. You're not going to be building a healthcare system in 10 minutes. It'll take years, 5, 10, 20 years. But it's worth doing. And if you don't do it, nobody else will. 5th, channel Neil Kalman. And I mean that with great seriousness. You know, I told you about the first 2 primary care heroes. The 3rd is sitting in this room. What Neil has done, you know, over the last 30 years, which I've watched, you know, to build a network of primary care is the chassis of a healthcare system for the state of New York. And as that expands, that's the way we will get to universal primary care. And universal primary care is how we build a healthcare system, how we reduce healthcare cost, and how we take the money that's being wasted and spend it instead on education and housing and public safety and public transportation, which turn out to be the things that matter for health. So, you know, when I was sort of revising this talk, this was, you know, I try to revise a talk like this for different audiences. I was trying to struggle with, you know, how you do this in a big city, because big city, you know, I used to live in New York, so it's not like you can kind of go to the town hall so easily in New York. But what you can do, you know, and I didn't know if I had that argument, but what you can do is, you know, understand what Neil's done and try to duplicate it. If you live in a city, you can do some other things too, which is call up friends in healthcare and organize inside healthcare itself. That means, you know, help unions demand pay linkage so that the folks at the top aren't making more than 5 or 10 times what the folks at the bottom are making. You know, there are ways of boycotting hospitals until we get real people on boards so that hospitals make decisions for communities and not for executives. There are times and places, I suspect, to boycott pharma, you know, to sort of begin to organize so we strike against stupid forms and stupid rules, of which you know many. But the only way that's going to happen is if we do it together. I kind of kid around about Occupy CMS, but I think we probably should at some point, because CMS is often part of the problem more than it is part of the solution. And remember that if you don't do this, no one else will. Finally, join the Right Care Alliance, which is the Lown Institute, whose board I'm on, has been organizing colleagues from around the country to put together a political revolution in healthcare. And that's structured around councils and chapters. There is a family medicine council run by Alan Roth at Jamaica Hospital. And there's, I don't know if there's a New York chapter yet, but there's gonna be. There's a Boston chapter and a Washington chapter and a Denver chapter. And the idea is to build a national movement from the ground up. And finally, if you're a resident and getting done and don't want to stay around New York for some reason, come join us in Central Falls and help us build this first healthcare system in the United States, or build one of your own right here. And as Baird Rustin said, we need in every community a group of angelic troublemakers. I would argue that those angelic troublemakers have already been selected and are sitting in this room. So please go out and do it. That's what the new neighborhood health station in Central Falls looks like, but there ought to be one in every single community of 10,000 people in the United States. And when we get that built, we begin to make a healthcare system that's for people and leave markets for selling tomatoes. Thank you. So the question was, even if we shift spending toward primary care, we're not likely to spend on social determinants. So what can we do to shift spending toward social determinants as well as spend on primary care? I have a backdoor answer, which is in order to get the shift to primary care done, everybody's going to have to build a political revolution in healthcare. We're going to have to build a national movement to get that done. And if we don't use that national movement to change spending so that we do spend on social determinants, then we're wasting our time. So we have to do both together. Dr. Kalman.
When you were in Rhode Island or more recently, did you think about maybe using healthcare as kind of like, I'm thinking of it from a governmental point of view, that maybe the healthcare system incorporates public housing, incorporates, you know, the food system, incorporates all of these other agencies that deal with other aspects of social determinants? Because, you know, health seems to be compelling, right? Sort of the most compelling of all, and also has the most money in it. And I'm wondering if there's a way, you know, in New York, everything has its own place in government and its own agencies and its own folks, but there's no overarching sort of view of it all as fitting together from a person point of view, which is that people need all that stuff to be healthy, right?
So the question is, can we use, and have we in Rhode Island found a way to use healthcare as an organizing principle to bring an address to social determinants together in one place and think about the funding of that? And the answer is actually yes. In this neighborhood health station in Central Falls, we do a multidisciplinary team meeting every Friday at 1:15. And around the table comes not only the medical folks, but two mental health agencies, the housing agency of the city, the police, EMS, a couple of social service agencies, and we sit and we do flip rounds on the 20 or 30 or 40 most vulnerable people in the city. And we worked, we have the state's housing organization. We finally got the folks from the parole board to come, because a lot of the people who run into trouble are ex-offenders, and you know, part of what we're trying to do is prevent that. The substance abuse issues are huge, and we do it together. Now, that hasn't helped us fund the others yet, but Rhode Island has a Medicaid waiver, and through the Medicaid waiver, we will eventually be able to spend money on, you know, on air conditioners for people with asthma, and on housing first for people who are trapped by substance abuse, because, you know, it's pretty clear that the housing first model is a critical model to people who are in that much trouble. So it's you got to walk on both feet like that. So I'm gonna. The question is, how do you counter the huge power of vested interests like hospitals, who leverage the fact that they're big employers in order to get political power? How do you make the argument the other way? And I think the answer is twofold. One is, you articulate the economic advantage of healthcare in communities. So, turns out that for every 10,000 people, we spend $100 million on healthcare. And much of that money, if you follow the money, ends up in the pockets of people who live in the small, rich parts. So healthcare functions as a almost like colonialism for poor communities. If you can go around and we do this, say, well, gee whiz, what we're going to do means we're going to keep some of that $100 million in this community. You build a political base that way. We figured out that the neighborhood health station in Central Falls is going to employ about 150 people. And that's an argument that we need to make. But the other piece is, the real way to counter that political power is to create a political revolution in healthcare. This isn't going to happen if we ask. This is only going to happen if we create the political space for it. And the only way to do that is by organizing. I was serious when I said the way to make this work is for everybody in this room to get five people together in their living room and build from there and meet every month. That is the only way to make this happen. And we articulated this, I think, very convincing approach to building a healthcare system in Rhode Island. And we couldn't get it done right then because there wasn't the political space for it. And sort of as a result of that, I left state government to go and work locally and begin to build you know, the political organization community by community so that we can get this done. But your point is really well taken. In Vermont, where they have a universal primary care proposal before the legislature, who's blocking it? The hospitals. How absurd is that? You know, I mean, here we are talking about a healthcare service that really good evidence shows will reduce cost by 20, 30, 40% and improve health outcomes. And it's being blocked by other healthcare organizations. So what are we all about? Are we about healthcare or something else? It will remain a constant fight, but I would argue the only way to counter that is to organize itself. And, you know, just in Rhode Island, a couple of us got involved in that organizing, working through an organization called Working Families, and we managed to take down the majority leader of the House, and are building a base of progressive legislators who give us the opportunity to change the political structure of the state at the end of the day. And, you know, I mean, I think that's the only way to do this. You know, you got to be there locally, building healthcare that matters locally, and you got to be there politically, you know, building a political base for this to move forward. And it seems like a lot of work when you're a resident and are working too many hours. And it is a lot of work, but the challenge is that if you don't do it, it ain't going to change.
Yeah, you're talking a lot about organizing on the local level, which certainly makes a lot of sense. But given what's going on nationally right now, do you have any advice for where to put your good where it will do the most?
The question is, given what's going on nationally, how should people direct their energy? And that's a struggle that I think one, that's a real struggle. I guess my sense is you kind of have to walk on both feet a little bit. But I'm a little bit politically pragmatic. I don't think we're going to win the ACA stuff and just counting votes, though we might. But even if that's won, we still have to do this other organizing, because, you know, even if we keep the ACA, it does in fact run out of gas in a few years because there's no way to control healthcare cost. Nothing in the ACA controls healthcare cost. The ACA was able to reduce cost to the government for what it was spending on Medicare. But it doesn't reduce healthcare costs generally, and it's healthcare costs generally that's sinking communities and sinking individuals as we transfer money from individuals to big corporate entities. And I think we're probably out of time.
Stop formally, but maybe you can hang around for a few minutes.
Yeah. Be pleased.
Discussion. That'd be great. Thank you very much.
Thank you all.